Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. Displayed are the list of news articles selected for today's analysis and their page numbers in Chennai, Delhi, Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping of the news articles are provided in the description box, and the timestamping for the benefit of mobile phone viewers is also been given in the comment section. Now let us move on to the first news article. Now this editorial article is about foreign policy challenges that India has in comparison with what was before some 5 years ago, simply between 2014 and the present time 2019. Now this will be part of your prelims under current events of national importance, and in mains, GS paper 2 in India and its neighborhood relations, bilateral, regional and global groupings and agreements involving India and affecting India's interests, or agreements that do not involve India but affecting India's interests, and also under effect of policies and politics of developed and developing countries on India's interests and also on Indian diaspora. Now the author opens the editorial with the recent developments in the global scenario that adds complexity to the Indian foreign policy challenges in dealing with the rise of China. The global scenario in 2019 is not the same as it was in 2014. Now, one of the recent developments is in the side of United States, with Mr. Donald Trump winning the presidential election in United States. See, the author says this because victory of Donald Trump gave a new dose of unpredictability in the United States policy decisions. For example, nobody expected that United States will withdraw from Trans-Pacific Partnership, and many didn't expect that United States will withdraw from Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, or in other words, the Iran nuclear deal. There were also a host of several other issues as well in which unpredictable decisions were made with respect to United States. Then if you see the ongoing trade war between United States and China, and if you see the nature of this trade war is now becoming a technology war. This technological nature is said because of the US restrictions in Chinese investments in the high-tech areas in the United States, and various restrictions were also placed on Chinese high-tech companies and similar restrictions. And on the other hand, if you take European Union, they are more preoccupied with the Brexit or British exit deal, that is the exit of Britain from the European Union. And recently, we could see more erosion of US-Russia arms control agreements. Now, there are some arms control treaty between United States and Russia, such as SALT 1, SALT 2, START 1, START 2, SALT treaty, INF treaty, that is Intermediate Range Nuclear Forces treaty. The author says that recently we have seen several violations in these arms control treaties, and we could see new, you know, an invigorated arms race happening in nuclear space and also in cyber regimes. And US has also announced withdrawal from the Iran nuclear deal in May 2018. This deal is also called as Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action. And there is also increasing or rising tensions between Saudi Arabia and Iran. And we also saw tensions increasing between Iran and United States as well in the recent times. So author says that all these, you know, recent developments somehow add complexity in handling China, or the rise of China, through the Indian foreign policy. See, that is, the global environment has become highly unpredictable these days. Now he comes to neighborhood. Here he talks about the invitations extended to the neighboring countries for the recent swearing-in ceremony of the top leadership in our country. The author states that India did not want to invite Pakistan, and that is why it did not invite SAARC countries this time. We know that in 2014, when Prime Minister Narendra Modi was swearing in, he invited SAARC countries. But this time he invited BIMSTEC countries only to avoid Pakistan. But know that it affected Maldives and Afghanistan, because they are not member countries of BIMSTEC. And we could know that that is one of the reasons that that would have made our Indian Prime Minister to make his first visit after the swearing-in to take into Maldives. Now, in addition to BIMSTEC, India also invited Kyrgyzstan. Now, you note that the Kyrgyzstan is the present chair in the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. And the invitation was also extended to Mauritius this time. The India-Pakistan relations, it got strained, but then it became very severely strained since 2016, September, when the Uri terror attack happened. And recently we know about the Pulwama terrorist attack and the aftermath with respect to it, the Balakot airstrike and another. So with regards to Pakistan, the author states that rather than having no communication between the two countries, it is better to have some kind of low-key and careful dialogues, because low-key means dialogues that is happening but without much sound and noise. Quiet dialogue. The author says that some kind of dialogue should go on between the two countries, because these things may help in giving nuances and leverages at the required time. With respect to neighborhood, the author is asking India not to show dominance in the region, rather to generate a broad-based consent. Dominance and playing favorites in the region could have been helpful in a pre-globalized world and in a world where there is no China asserting its power. Now China is asserting its power in the region and there is globalization. In this scenario, dominance and playing favorites will not work. So now things have changed. India have to make some solid action-based commitments with the nations in the region, and India should become generous as a larger economy in the region. That is what the neighboring countries expect. That is what will make India's support credible to them. For example, India should provide more line of credit, financial assistance to the nearby countries. And also the government shall have a more confident and coordinated approach in handling neighborhood organizations such as SAARC, BIMSTEC, Bangladesh-Bhutan-India-Nepal Initiative, Bangladesh-China-India-Myanmar Forum for Regional Cooperation, and the Indian Ocean Rim Association. Equal attention of bilateral importance shall be given to all these neighborhood organizations in handling them. And the central government or the government of India shall provide necessary attention to the state governments so as to foster or encourage or to create closer linkages with the state governments of India with the bordering neighbor countries. Then the author comes to managing China and the United States. See, according to the author, China will continue to be the most important issue, at least even for next 5 years as well. The author suggests that changes should be made to the foreign policy with respect to China, because the present policy is the old policy since 1980s, which the focus of which has been on growing economic, commercial and cultural relations with China, while at the same time maintaining differences on boundary disputes by having dialogues and confidence building measures. According to this author, this policy is no longer sustainable. As we could see, the Doklam standoff happened between two countries in 2017. Now, Doklam is a place in Bhutan where Chinese army was about to build a road infrastructure in 2017. Bhutan and India were strongly against it, and after 71 days, the standoff was resolved diplomatically. And the author feels that the gap between India and China is growing and there has to be steps taken to address it. With respect to United States, the authors say that it is a fickle partner. Now, fickle partner means a partner who is frequently not loyal. Now, we have taken several diplomatic efforts with the United States since or after the testing of nuclear test in 1998. Even though we have taken this many efforts in building the relations between India and United States, India was unable to continue the waiver to import oil from Iran. It also could not be a beneficiary in GSP program. Recently, in month of May, we found that US has announced the currently looming issue between India and the United States is about the sanctions under the United States legislation of CATSA. That is, if India makes a payment or if India purchases S-400 air and missile defense system from Russia, then India will be facing sanctions from the United States. Now, CATSA stands for Countering America's Adversaries Through Sanctions Act, recently enabled legislation of United States. Now, there are some other issues. The United States does not want India to allow Huawei in 5G trials in Indian telecom industry. And there is a kind of reconciliation talks going on between United States and Taliban in Afghanistan. And India is potentially concerned about the return of Taliban in Afghanistan after once United States leaves completely from Afghanistan. In such a global scenario, India cannot remain non-aligned. See, if China has some distance or some is standing against Russia, that is, if China moves closer to United States, then India has to move closer to Russia. See, if China is moving closer to Russia, then India has to do external balancing with the United States. Now, the present reality is that China and Russia are having a common front against United States. And this means India has to externally balance China by moving closer to United States. But United States, as we have seen already, is a frequently disloyal partner. Or a fickle part. Now, this is the reality. In such a scenario, we have to maintain Indian foreign policy. The author says that India lacks the ability to shape events around it as it is having limitations in resources. Now, if you see whether it is India or China with respect to investments or in giving line of credit to our neighbor countries, India is certainly lagging in this area. And India should take credible steps to help the neighbor countries. And we need to have synergized action and coordination in expanding foreign policy establishment in our neighborhood. Now, this means when a specific effort is taken in a neighboring country, it is not just the Ministry of External Affairs. Rather, there should be synergy or collective coordination of all the relevant ministries. For example, if a project is with respect to agriculture, then Ministry of Agriculture has to be involved in it. The synergy of the ministry has to be utilized. And relevant ministries, industries, and other stakeholders have to be part of such a effort taken in our neighborhood country. Author suggests that India lags in project implementation. So there has to be urgent attention and evaluation of Indian investments and the project implementation that we have taken up in our neighboring countries. We should note that all these relationships and developments are interlinked and add to complexity in foreign policy. So to create a conducive regional environment, apt utilization or employment of external balancing along with new domestic consensus is required. Now, by saying domestic consensus or by having a new consensus at home, the author could be implying that there has to be alignment of opinions on how to engage with all these countries and the countries in the neighborhood, all right? And there has to be alignment or consensus among people, among the top leadership, among bureaucracy, among industries, white parties or ministries also. So with this, now let us move on to our analysis of next news article. The displayed practice question will be discussed in the final session. Now, this article will be relevant in prelim syllabus, in current events of national and international importance, and in mains under GS paper 2 in India and its neighborhood relations, and in bilateral regional groupings and agreements involving India and affecting India's interests, and in effect of policies of developing countries on India's interests, and in important international institutions, agencies, their structure and mandate. Now, it states that Indian Prime Minister will meet the presidents of Russia, China and Uzbekistan. This is going to happen in the Shanghai Cooperation Organization Summit, which is to be held on June 14 in this month in the place Bishkek, that is the capital of Kyrgyz Republic, which is the chair in this Shanghai Cooperation Organization at present. Now, this will be the first multilateral meeting of Indian Prime Minister after his re-election in the Lok Sabha election. Now, there will be various issues such as terrorism, issues relating to Afghanistan, regional security, multilateral dialogues and global scenario that are to be discussed during this summit. Now, it is expected that the meeting with Russia and the meeting with China will be a bilateral meeting. That is India-Russia and India-China. We have received similar requests from other countries as well. But so far, another expectation is that India will have a bilateral discussion with Uzbekistan as well. Now, we know that the first informal summit between India and China was held last year, 2018, in Wuhan in China. Now, there is a possibility of the second informal summit between India and China in this year later. See, India is also participating in the regional anti-terror structure of Shanghai Cooperation Organization. See, we have been participating in tactical drills and counter-terror operation with other member countries of Shanghai Cooperation Organization under this RADS framework. And in August 2018, India, Pakistan and other countries joined in a tactical military exercise under this RADS framework. And this year also, India is expected to participate in a military exercise in Russia under the RADS. Now, we'll study about Shanghai Cooperation Organization, this RADS framework, and the importance of both in the Indian point of view. Now, the formation of Shanghai Cooperation Organization was declared on 15 June 2001 in Shanghai. It was declared as an intergovernmental multilateral platform. Now, before 2001, it was called Shanghai 5 because at that time it had only 5 members such as China, Russia, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan. The Shanghai 5 was established in 1996 and the purpose was mainly to deal with boundary issues between China, Russia and the newly independent 5 states of Central Asian region. Now, of these 5 newly independent states, 3 of them were Kazakhstan, Kyrgyz Republic and Tajikistan. And it is stated that they share boundaries with China and Russia. The Shanghai 5 was formed with the signing of a Treaty on Deepening Military Trust in Border Regions and the Treaty on Reduction of Military Forces in Border Regions. In 2001, this organization, this Shanghai 5, evolved into Shanghai Cooperation Organization with the inclusion of Uzbekistan in the group. If you see at present, the Shanghai Organization or SCO consists of 8 full members and India, China, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Pakistan, Russia, Tajikistan and Uzbekistan are 8 full-time members. Now, this organization has 4 observer states as of now. They are Afghanistan, Iran, Belarus and Mongolia. And if you see the dialogue partners, they are Azerbaijan, Armenia, Cambodia, Nepal, Turkey and Sri Lanka, right? If you see the observer states, it has Afghanistan, Iran. If you see the dialogue partners, our neighbors, Sri Lanka and Nepal are there. And of the 5 republics of Central Asia, one country that has not joined this organization, that is not a member country of this organization, is Turkmenistan. Now, was India a founding member or was India a part of this institution since 2001? No, because only in 2017, India got complete membership of this SCO organization with the support of all the member countries of this organization at that point of time. Prior to that, India was acting as an observer state. Now, let's talk about this SCO charter. See, we see it's a part of a regional organization. Any regional organization will have a set of, the charter will have a set of rules like this. See, it came into effect in 2003. Aims for strengthening the mutual trust and neighborliness among member states, promotion of cooperation in various fields, and one special thing is it also talks about environmental protection, and the charter also calls for making joint efforts to maintain and ensure peace, security and stability in the region, right? And it aims to move towards the establishment of democratic, fair and rational new international political and economic order. So when we say new international political and economic order, one of the objectives is promoting growth and equitable development
in developing and least developed countries. Now, what is the highest decision-making body within this Shanghai Cooperation Organization? It is the Heads of State Council. The Council of Heads of State, Heads of Member Countries. So it meets annually, that is every year at one point it meets and take decisions and adopt various guidelines on all important matters. Now there are two permanent bodies. One is Shanghai Cooperation Organization Secretariat and the other is the Executive Committee of the Regional Anti-Terrorist Structure, Executive Committee of the RATS. Now the SCO Secretariat is in Beijing and SCO RATS is based in Tashkent in the country Uzbekistan. So SCO RATS is a permanent body of SCO or Shanghai Cooperation Organization. The main purpose is to facilitate coordination and interaction between various authorities of SCO member states to fight against three evils. According to SCO, these three evils are terrorism, extremism and separatism. And other functions are coordination and information sharing. Right. And since becoming a member, India has been participating in almost all the activities of SCO RATS. And within this SCO RATS framework, there are legal foundations or legal framework for cooperation among member countries. And it will have anti-terrorism operations, joint counter-terrorism exercises, and thereby ensuring security. They have also established a secure database with updated information on people and organizations, those who are wanted with respect to terrorism, separatism and extremism. Now there are some 19 universal conventions and protocols on combating terrorism by this Shanghai Cooperation Organization. This RATS SCO framework also monitors the status of ratification by the member states of SCO of these universal conventions of Shanghai Cooperation Organization. This RATS SCO has cooperation with various organizations such as UNODC. In UNODC, there is a branch called Terrorism Prevention Branch. With them, they have a relationship by a signed protocol. And it has also signed MOUs with ASEAN and Interpol. And they also have cooperation with Eurasian Group on Combating Money Laundering and Financing of Terrorism, shortly called as EAG. They also cooperate with United Nations Security Council Counter-Terrorism Committee. You note that there is a terrorism prevention branch of UNODC and there is a Eurasian group on combating money laundering and financing of terrorism in European region. And within United Nations Security Council, you know that there is a Counter-Terrorism Committee. Now let's see the importance of Shanghai Cooperation Organization for our country. Now when joining, it had with the purpose of several geostrategic considerations, economic interests, energy and cultural outreach, India has joined. And the complete membership of India in this organization, it actually raises India's stature or posture in this Eurasian region. And with this platform, India can play a greater role in the region's security and economic development. So now India actually got a boost because earlier there were lack of direct land transport linkages, particularly with Central Asia and Afghanistan, we could see. This SCO, having a membership in SCO, can actually help increase India's connectivity with Afghanistan, Central Asia and Eurasia. So when connectivity is increasing, when connectivity is improving, obviously the trade and commerce will be boosted up. Now India has announced its Connect Central Asia policy in the year 2012 in the first India Central Asia dialogue, which was held in Kyrgyzstan in the location Bishkek. If you ask what is the main or important component of this Connect Central Asia policy of 2012, it is improving connectivity. And in addition to improving connectivity, trade and commerce, there is also an important factor of energy security by joining the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, particularly with the SCO Energy Club. So this relationship with the SCO will obviously help to, strengthen energy cooperation between Central Asia and India. See, the member countries of SCO have about around 25% of global oil reserves. And if you take in terms of natural gas resource, they have 50%. And with respect to coal resource, almost 33%. And uranium reserves, almost 50% of world's known uranium reserves are available among the member countries of SCO. Now, some of the other issues faced by the member countries of SCO are, you know, terrorism, as we already seen, drug trafficking, small arms smuggling, and related security challenges. With this, let's move on to next news article. Now, this news article is about uranium enrichment by Iran. Now, this article will be relevant in prelims under current events of international importance, and in mains in GS paper 2 under important international institutions, agencies, structure and mandate, because at the end we will be discussing about International Atomic Energy Agency. Now, before entering, we'll have a view on this Iran nuclear deal. It's also called as Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action. Now, this deal was arrived between Iran and other countries in 2015 in the month of July. Now, the main objective is to ensure that the nuclear program in Iran should be exclusively peaceful. Now, the countries, you know, that have entered in the deal with Iran are United States, UK, Russia, China, France, and Germany. And therefore, the deal is between Iran and P5 plus 1. When we say plus 1, it means Germany. P5 are permanent members of United Nations Security Council. They are USA, UK, Russia, China, and France. And additionally, European Union is also party to this deal. Now, India is not a party to this Iran nuclear deal. And after signing this deal, Iran was allowed to have trade relationship with various countries, particularly in oil and banking transactions, as United States lifted the sanctions on Iran. But what happened in May 2018, we have seen that United States withdraw from Iran nuclear deal in May 2018 because it felt that the deal does not have enough provisions to effectively control the nuclear program of Iran. Now, one important provision of the deal is that Iran cannot hold the surplus enriched uranium with itself, and therefore it has to sell the surplus enriched uranium to international buyers. So now Iran is facing huge sanctions from United States, and therefore Iran says that it will not sell the surplus enriched uranium in future if the countries that are party to the deal do not assist Iran from US sanctions. And Iran claims that it can lower its commitments according to the deal if a member of the party violates the deal. In the first week of May 2019, the Iran president gave a 60-day time period to the countries that are party to this Iran nuclear deal or this Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action. And it requested to the countries to find a solution for Iran's oil trade against US sanctions. Now, the president of Iran also warned that if the negotiations did not start at least immediately after the 60-day period, Iran will start enriching uranium at higher levels than prescribed by the Iran nuclear deal. Now, the news is that Iran has accelerated the uranium enrichment. The International Atomic Energy Agency has stated that the production rate of enriched uranium in Iran is increasing. It is stated that Iran is now producing more enriched uranium while comparing with the previous times, or it producing more enriched uranium than before, but it is still not clear when it will reach the limits set by the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action. Now, after the strain in Iran-USA relations, particularly since May 2018, when United States withdraw itself from Iran nuclear deal, a foreign minister from Germany has visited Iran, and he has become one of the most senior Western official to visit Iran since the strain in Iran-USA relationships. Now, for all the escalation of problems, Iran's foreign ministry is blaming the United States. And they have also assured that Iran will cooperate with European signatories of the deal, that is United Kingdom, France, and Germany. Now, if you consider this International Atomic Energy Agency, now it is an autonomous international organization within United Nations system. It was created in the year 1957 because at that time there were greater fears and expectations that are generated by the discovery of nuclear technology, and they found that the nuclear technology could be used in diverse ways, and there were a lot of fears And in response to that, this International Atomic Energy Agency was created. And it is the International Center for Cooperation in the Nuclear Field. Our main purpose is to promote safe, secure, and peaceful use of nuclear technologies all over the world. India is a member of this International Atomic Energy Agency since 1957. Now, this headquarters of International Atomic Energy Agency is located in Vienna, which is in the country Austria. Now, the displayed prelims question will be discussed in the last session. With this, let's move on to next news article. Now, this news article is an editorial about revised RBI circular with respect to non-performing assets or non-performing loans. The author of this editorial has appreciated the balanced approach taken by RBI in the revised circular. Now, this will be relevant in your prelim syllabus under current events of national importance and in economic development. It means in GS paper 3 under Indian economy. Now, this revised circular of RBI is titled as Prudential Framework for Resolution of Stressed Assets. And this circular was recently issued on 7th June. In a same way, a similar circular was issued by RBI on February 12 of 2018. But that particular circular was struck down by the Supreme Court as ultra vires. Ultra vires means acting beyond one's legal authority. That is, RBI issuing directions beyond the powers it has been vested with. Or in other words, RBI does not have power to do so. Now, the new circular is applicable to various entities such as scheduled commercial banks, All India Term Financial Institutions, which includes NABARD, National Housing Bank, Exim Bank, that is Export-Import Bank of India, Small Industrial Development Bank of India, and small finance banks, and also to systemically important non-deposit-taking NBFCs and deposit-taking NBFCs. Note that it is not applicable to regional rural banks. Now, RBI has the right to direct banks to initiate insolvency proceedings in specific cases because of its powers, by using its powers under Section 35AA of Banking Regulation Act of 1949. So, based on this provision only, the new circular was issued by RBI. Now, the main purpose of issuing these directions by RBI is to provide a framework for early recognition and early reporting and time-bound resolution of stressed assets. Now, what is stressed assets? See, a company borrows money from a bank for various business purposes or projects. Now, the borrowed money is called as principal. Now, for this principal, company has to pay some amount as interest. Now, if this principal or even the interest is not paid by a company for more than 90 days, then such accounts are called as such assets or such borrowed money are called as non-performing assets, or in short, NPA. Sometimes these loans are either written off by the banks so as to save some of the bank's money from paying tax, or these loans are restructured, or these loans are modified as fresh loans so that they may not be classified as NPAs. So all these non-performing assets, write-offs and restructured loans can be called as stressed assets of a bank. See, restructured loan is a loan that is just restructured. Only the liens have been given. The loan amount is not yet paid back when we mean restructured loans. So therefore, restructured loans are also a stressed asset of a bank. Now, these are called as stressed assets because the bank or the creditor does not know whether it will receive the money back or not. And there have been wide accumulation of more non-performing assets, and this has led to various problems in the banking system across India. So the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code was introduced in the year 2016. Now, as per Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, when a company defaults on a loan of 1 lakh or more, now the banks or the creditors can approach National Company Law Tribunal. And in this mechanism, the banks can initiate proceedings under Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. So when the banks initiate proceedings under IBC, NCLT will grant moratorium of 180 days, or roughly 6 months. So that, the creditors can come up with a uniform resolution plan by working together. Now, a moratorium period in this context is a time during the loan term when the borrower is not required to make any payment. Now, in this mechanism, a single bank, right, a single creditor to a particular person cannot take actions unilaterally. That is, if a person has borrowed money from 5 banks, in this resolution plan, a single bank cannot take actions on its own or unilaterally. So within that 180 days, an insolvency professional will make a resolution plan. Now, this resolution plan can be, you know, like providing some concession in the interest rates or some concession in the principal amount, or even extending the time duration within which, you know, the amount can be paid, and it could be several other measures as well. If 75% of the creditors or the 75% of the banks agree with the resolution plan, then the resolution plan will be made into action. Otherwise, the insolvency professional will liquidate or sell the assets of client and recover the dues. Now, the new circular issued by RBI says that banks will have the freedom to decide whether they can drag the defaulter to the adjudicating authority or not. Now, let's see some of the author's comments on RBI's approach in its recently released circular. Now, for understanding, we'll also see the difference in approach between this new circular and the old circular that was released on February 2018. See, the new circular manages to retain the spirit of the original version, while at the same time, it was able to accommodate the concerns of banks and borrowers, because the older version was very stricter on banks. Now, according to the new circular, if the borrower defaults the payment, then banks can review and decide on the resolution strategy within 30 days. Now, according to original circular that is published on February 2018, the review period was just 1 day. So with the huge operational constraints within the banking system, the banks found 1 day review period as very difficult to follow and very not practical. But now on the revised circular, the bank has enough time to review and come up with a resolution strategy. Now in this new system, banks or the creditors have the freedom to decide whether they have to take the defaulter to the adjudicating authority or not when resolution is not taking place within 180 days of resolution plan. That is, within 180 days of finalizing or making the resolution plan. In the earlier circular, there was no such options available to the banks. And RBI has made the inter-creditor agreement between lenders as a mandatory one. By this, RBI has ensured that the banks will, you know, have a collective or a common voice. So coming to inter-creditor agreement, see, we saw that the companies get loans from different banks at the same time for a particular project or particular business. When they default on the loans, it was difficult for banks to come up with a common resolution plan. So to overcome this challenge, an inter-creditor agreement came into effect since July 2018. Here, creditor means banks who have lent the money. And the term inter-creditor agreement means agreement between different creditors or agreement between different banks. See, as per this inter-creditor agreement, the lead creditor will be authorized to formulate a resolution plan. Lead creditor is the one who has given maximum money to the borrower. And this plan will be presented to other lenders for their approval. All those creditors who are opposing the resolution plan will have the option to sell their stressed loans. Now, for example, if there are two banks, A and B, A has given 70% of the credit to a company, B has given 30%, and A have formulated a resolution plan, B does not agree, then B can sell the 30% asset to the bank A. A will pay whatever the money required to bank B, and bank A will get the money from the borrower. Now, the bank B is no more in the picture. This inter-creditor agreement aims to quickly resolve the stressed asset issues. Now, this is because the resolution process should not be stalled because of other small lenders. Now, RBI has made this inter-creditor agreement mandatory. The RBI has also put a condition that dissenting lenders or disagreeing lenders, you know, the small creditors, should not get less than the liquidation value. They should get the commensurating value. So RBI has set a limit on recovery for the small creditors from the resolution process. So ultimately, RBI is aiming for faster resolution of stressed assets so that the banking system is not affected for a long time with non-performing or stressed assets. Now, there is one more point with respect to delayed implementation of the resolution plan. Here, RBI discourages the delay in the implementation of resolution plan by imposing some additional provisions. Now, the key point here to note is that RBI wants the banks to resolve non-performing assets within 180 day limit or transfer the issue to the adjudicating authority. Earlier, the banks were, you know, either kept restructuring the loans or giving lenience to the borrowers, or they kept this or hide the non-performing assets. Now, with this new circular, with the new freedom given to banks, author hopes that the banks will take some concrete or positive steps as per the direction given by the Reserve Bank of India. Now, the author also suggests that the government has to assess what is affecting the insolvency resolution process in our country. Now, there are some defaulters wherein the defaulted, you know, the money will be huge. For example, SR Steel, whose resolution is still pending. So there is a lot of delay. So the author suggests that the government should address major concerns such as the delays in the resolution process and the other loopholes in the system. So now let us move on to next news article. Now the displayed mains question will be discussed in the last session. Now this news article deals with the process of extradition. Now the analysis of this news article will be relevant in prelim syllabus under current events of national and international importance and in mains and GS paper 2 under global agreements involving India and or affecting India's interests and bilateral agreements as well. The effects of policies and politics of developing countries on India's interests. Now, extradition means delivery of criminals or surrendering of fugitives to the requested country. Extradition is the delivery of an accused or a convicted individual to the country in whose territory the alleged crime has taken place. For example, if a person of a country B, if a person who is citizen of country B has committed a crime in country A, then country A will request to surrender the person from country B. And this process of surrendering is called as extradition. Now, India is party to many multilateral conventions that provide binding extradition framework to prevent or to stop transnational crimes such as corruption, organized crime, drug trafficking, terrorism, and aircraft hijacking. So no country in the world, including India, has extradition treaties with all the nations of the world. If you see, India has extradition treaties with some more than 40 countries, around 43 countries, and extradition arrangements with 10 nations. The extradition arrangements are non-binding and they do not impose any legal obligations international level on the party states. Whereas in a treaty, there is binding. It is binding and it has some legal obligations based on the particular treaty. Now, for extradition, India can make a request to a particular country when India's extradition treaty partners have their treaty obligations to consider India's request. But when it is a non-treaty state or in the absence of a treaty, it is just a matter of the foreign country to consider based on its domestic laws and procedures. Or sometimes the country can agree to India's extradition request. It may seek a response of reciprocity. That is, in a similar ground, when that country requests, when that country makes an extradition request, India should support. Now, it is stated that Section 3, Subsection 4 of Indian Extradition Act of 1962 provides a legal basis for the extradition requests of India with respect to non-treaty states. Now, the news article talks about extradition of Zakir Naik, who is wanted by India for the offense of money laundering. Now, it is stated that the Enforcement Directorate is preparing to secure a non-bailable warrant against Zakir Naik on money laundering charges. They say that some amount of some more than 190 crore is involved. Now, the Enforcement Directorate can request the Interpol to issue a red notice against him based on this non-bailable warrant, and it can also approach the Malaysian government, where we can see Zakir Naik, to seek his extradition. The Malaysian Prime Minister has said that Malaysia reserves the right to not allow the extradition of Zakir Naik to India because he feels that he is not going to get a fair trial in our country. Now, Interpol is an acronym for International Criminal Police Organization. It is also intergovernmental organization because it has some 194 member countries. India is also one of the member, and it helps in policing all the member nations to work together. Major objective is to keep the world as a safer place. It helps the member nations to share and access data or information on crimes and criminals, particularly those who, you know, evade justice by escaping from one country to another. Our red notice by Interpol just alerts the police worldwide about internationally wanted criminals or fugitives. A red notice is a request to law enforcement agencies worldwide, you know, to locate and provisionally arrest a person against whom extradition or surrender or some legal action is pending. Now, a red notice will have two type of information. One with respect to the person, name, DOB, date of birth, his hair and physical appearance, so as to aid in locating the person and also identifying the person. And the second is with respect to for what crime the particular person is wanted, for what offense, whether it is armed robbery or whether it is child abuse, etc. Now, generally, red notices are published by Interpol at the request of a particular member country. Now, we should know that it is not an international arrest warrant. A red notice is a request. Based on that, a police of a particular member state can arrest or cannot. But it is not an international arrest warrant. Whereas in an international arrest warrant, the police of a particular country will secure arrest of a particular person. Because Interpol cannot compel the law enforcement authorities in a particular country to arrest someone who is the subject of a red notice. If a person is subject of international arrest warrant, arrest has to be made. Therefore, with respect to red notice, it is up to a member country to decide what legal value or respect it has to give to the notice. Now, with this, we come to the end of this article discussion. Now, let us move on to next session, practice cum revision session. Now, this question is with respect to International Atomic Energy Agency. They have given two statements and are asking which of the statements are correct. International Atomic Energy Agency was created in 1957 to promote safe, secure and peaceful use of nuclear technologies. Now, this statement is correct, and also the year. It is only in 1957. This agency was created, and way back since 1957, India has been a member. So therefore, the second statement is wrong. So the answer for this question is option A, one only. Now, this question is with respect to red notice of Interpol. So the question, a red notice is a request to law enforcement agencies worldwide to locate and provisionally arrest a person pending extradition, surrender or similar legal action. Which of the following issues the red notice? They have given four options: International Court of Justice, International Criminal Court, International Criminal Police Organization, and International Police Association. Today we saw that option C, Interpol or International Criminal Police Organization, issues red notice. So the answer for this question is option C. Now, this mains question in GS3, they're asking to assess the affirmative actions taken by RBI to resolve the growing stressed assets in Indian account. Now, this question, they are asking to assess the affirmative actions taken by RBI to resolve the growing stressed assets in Indian economy. Now, there could be various affirmative actions taken by RBI. You could list all those actions and assess them with respect to resolving the stressed assets in Indian economy. Now, based on today's discussion, you could assess how far the previous circular issued in February 2018, you know, was helpful in resolving the stressed assets, and how the new circular is having its advantages over the previous circular. And you could also say that even the Supreme Court in its assessment found that the earlier published circular was ultra vires or beyond the powers of RBI to issue such a circular. So you could highlight the new provisions with respect to the recent circular published by RBI, and using these informations, you can write in your mains answer. The next question with respect to GS paper 2, India's foreign policy requires much dynamic approach in the dynamic global scenario. Assess the India's challenges with respect to neighborhood and beyond. Now, the first statement, you need not focus all your energy and effort to write or explain about this statement. You could write in two lines or three lines or a one-liner with respect to the statement. You know, the recent developments in the world is leading to unpredictability in the global scenario, and therefore a dynamic In such a dynamic scenario, dynamic approach is required. So this is how you may start, and then you can assess India's challenges with respect to neighborhood. Now coming to neighborhood, you can assess with respect to challenges with respect to SAARC, challenges with respect to BIMSTEC, and if you know the specific challenges with respect to Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Nepal initiative, or Indian Ocean Rim Association, or you can also compare with respect to BCIM framework. So you can specifically talk about that, and you can say that with respect to SAARC, India has not been engaging now because of one country known as Pakistan, and you can assess these challenges. And also for beyond, you can talk about Southeast Asian region, China, Central Asia, and also with respect to United States. You can say with respect to challenges with respect to US, the recent failures, particularly with respect to GSP, and also United States not renewing the waiver so as to import oil from Iran, and US is threatening India with sanctions if India proceeds with purchasing or making payment with respect to S-400 air and air missile system from Russia. And all these things you can highlight in your main section based on today's editorial analysis. There could be more points you could add on in this. With this, we come to the end of today's The Hindu newspaper analysis. If you like the video, press the like button, comment, share, and subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for daily updates of The Hindu News Analysis.